we are running a little short of time, but there are two points that I would love to discuss on, and we already had discussion in classes. But for my viewers, once again, petrol prices and diesel prices.
Well, you tell me one thing, if the crude oil prices are going up in the world, now nobody is responsible for it. In fact, if government has been spending lakhs of crores of rupees on the subsidies which are given on fuel and fertilizer, what do you expect? For how long will it be sustainable? One day or the other, consumers of the petrol and diesel will have to pay the higher price. In fact, it is desirable that if you keep prices high, the non-conventional or the energy resources will be tapped if the price is very high. And this is, in my opinion, petrol and diesel price should be fairly, should be priced at very
in
high.
In fact, please bear in mind, they have not increased the price of the petrol.
Yeah,
they have only increased the excise duty. Okay, the price is still to be increased, and that may come in a month or
we may be in
for a much ruder surprise.
So, and which should be accepted as a crude fact in life, because if the crude oil prices are increasing every year, and they are not going to last forever. So you will have to pay higher price as the stocks will deplete, the prices will go up, and more importantly, to have solar energy or nuclear energy or any other energy to be tapped, you will have to have incentive for the companies who will develop all this. And they will develop only when they see a phenomenal profitable growth in the coming future. So petrol prices should be, accepted.
So, I should request all my friends to please lower down this petrol thing. Okay, final leg of the discussion is when FM started the part B, that is, the speech of taxation, he quoted the words of Kautilya, the great management guru that we all know and we should be proud of. I'll have to read because it's long. A wise collector general shall conduct a work of revenue collection in a manner that production and consumption should not be injuriously affected. Financial prosperity depends on public prosperity, abundance of harvest, and prosperity of commerce and other. Do you think he has justified using this quote after completing his speech?
Well, partly because of the fact that taxes have not been increased to the level where it would harm or have a negative impact on trade or manufacturing. But at the same time, it will definitely reduce the deficit of the government, which should be the first priority of any government, which would come in another one or two per decade also. So he has tried a very nice balance between what the revenue management should be and what the ways in which the revenue is to be taxed.
The way I look at it, it is a tightrope walk. One single mistake or lack of concentration here and there, and he is in for serious trouble.
But don't you think that if the tax were, the tax exemption which the government provides should have been increased from 160 to say around 180 lakh, 180,000?
Personal income tax.
Yeah,
tax. I would not comment on that.
But when we are talking about taxation, why we are ignoring the fact that for years there is a demand to tax agriculture, which has not been considered. And only to protect a certain section of society, the entire field is kept open.
So probably we'll have to rationalize, government will have to come.
Now that he has mentioned, let me point out one very interesting fact, that for centuries, agriculture has been taxed in India. Successive governments, successive kings, and dynasties have been generating a lot of revenue from agriculture, and that's how India has been a prosperous country.
And now you are talking about commercialization of agriculture.
And since independence, we have stopped taxing agriculture, and ever since, agriculture has gone downhill. That's a very interesting observation.
Thank you for that observation. So, we have almost completed everything. Sorry for the time limitation that we had. Is there anything that we might have missed and you would want to say to our viewers with respect to this budget, and how shall we be expecting our coming budget henceforth? Because now, as we see, we are moving from populist budget to a more realistic budget. The government is taking stand over inflation, price rise and other things, and constantly higher authorities have been fighting with opposition that we are firm on this stand. So how are we, anything to comment on that?
No, particularly for students of finance and MBA, I would highlight some provisions regarding banking. One is additional banking licenses, second is PSU bank capitalization, third is recapitalization of RRBs, that is also very important. Fourth is foods storing potential for increasing that. Fifth is interest subvention, and sixth is impetus to development of food processing industries.
So this capital raising or additional support of 16,500 crores.
Correct.
Now is this by way of saying that loan has been subvented for 6 more months? Loan, I mean interest on loan waivers. The government has extended that to 6 more months, and now it's saying that I'll give you additional capital. Or there is another hidden message in that?
No, there is no hidden message. The message is very clear. First, you strengthen your base, add additional capital by whatever means. You may borrow from the government or from some by public sector, public issue. Mm-hmm. But strengthen the capital. To a certain extent, the government is also helping the public sector.
We are moving towards a much better financial stability.
Yes, yes.
And strong banking in India.
Because they have learned lessons from financial company failures.
Okay, so they want our companies, our banks to be very strong, at least on the basis.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. With this, we come to end of our discussion. And thank you for being with us. We will certainly come up with second episode discussing something more important with tech education. Thank you very much.